10 years in the making, and really it's involved lots of stakeholders, but especially the residents of Kōlauloa, which I think is really important. And since I am brand new to this office, and this took 10 years to make it, I want to bring up a couple of people here that had a lot to do in making today happen. So first of all, I want to bring up Eugene Takahashi from our Department of Planning and Permitting, who really had a great deal to do with this. So Eugene.
Hi, thank you. Just wanted to let everyone know the department is extremely pleased that we have reached this moment. This has been a very long process. The existing plan is over 20 years old, and you know, we're very excited that it has reached this point. And one of the things that we want to highlight is what the plan brings, what the new plan brings. And these are the three highlights that I would like to bring forward. It adds principles of sustainability and provides updated language or climate change and sea level rise and important agricultural lands and language regarding Turtle Bay Resort. It incorporates the conservation easement that the residents in the Kōlauloa have advocated for over the Turtle Bay area. And it also updates the policy guidelines and preservation agriculture parks, cultural, residential, commercial, and light industrial areas and park uses. This plan, again, through a collaborative effort between the administration and city council, has come a long way, and we're very pleased he has reached this point. This shows where the administration and council working together, we can reach a consensus in moving forward in what we feel is in the best interest of the city and county of Honolulu. Thank you.
Thank you, Eugene. I want to underscore the really key point here, that the residents of Kōlauloa, their voices were heard and they were instrumental and very involved in this process. And you know, and none of this stuff doesn't happen without great leadership. And so I'm very proud to bring up Councilwoman Heidi Sunayoshi, who played a big part in making this happen.
Good morning. I just wanted to thank the mayor, Mayor Blangiardi, for this amazing opportunity to celebrate a very monumental event for the Kōlauloa communities, and thank you to Deputy Director Takahashi for being here as well. I also want to recognize the presence of Chair Waters, who will come up later, I hope, in the effort that was led within the last really couple months to really push this very important piece of legislation through. I'm pleased to have worked in the Kōlauloa communities for a decade now and saw the back and forth between residents. There was many ups and many downs within the communities. And after when taking office 2 years ago, I decided that this would be one of my top priorities to make sure that we build consensus within the communities and do what is right for the Kōlauloa communities and move forward on a plan that really brought a strong foundation and made sure that it showed that the people's voices were heard. And today I'm so pleased that Bill 79 is before us today, because it shows what can happen when residents stand up for their communities and what can happen when people are willing to come together for the common cause of making sure that we're working in the best interest of our communities, not just for now, but for future generations to come. So here in Bill 79, there's some very important and key elements to it that I just wanted to highlight. There was always and continues to be a concern for additional housing inventory in the Kōlauloa communities, which is addressed with allowing for infill development. There's also concerns about making sure we can maintain the rural character of the Kōlauloa communities, which is addressed in the community growth boundary line, staying in as a designated location to maintain the rural character of Kōlauloa and keeping agricultural lands open for agricultural purposes. As was mentioned before, there was also a lot of work done with Turtle Bay Resorts, and I do have to say a big mahalo and thank you to the management team of Turtle Bay for their concessions and their work with their residents and what was important to them with regard to conservation, preservation, and also agricultural opportunities. And I'm very pleased to announce that I've recently talked with Turtle Bay Resorts, and we are moving forward on actual agricultural activity on their mauka lands. There's already farming being done, which is going to support not only the hotel but the community with fresh fruits and vegetables. There's going to be a hydroponic facility opening in June and a packaging in July, and lots of good things working towards the issues of food security for the Kōlauloa community through the collaboration with Turtle Bay Resorts. So much good work has been done over a decade for this plan to come to fruition today. And I'm very excited that the people's voices were heard and included in this plan, thanks to the hard work of the department, thanks to moving forward with Chair Waters and Mayor Blangiardi. Thank you so much. And I look forward to this being the foundation of where we can build a very strong community for Ko'olaloa, that we can address infrastructure concerns, which are included also in the plan for flooding and for Kamehameha Highway, which we know is a very huge concern, and for recreational opportunities. And this stands our commitment from the city that we stand with the Ko'olaloa communities, with the administration and the council to support you and moving forward for the future of Ko'olaloa. Very thankful for this day, and thank you again, Mayor, Chair Waters. Thank you to Deputy Director Takahashi and all of those who came before and worked on this amazing plan. Thank you.
Well, on behalf of the residents of Ko'olaloa, let me just acknowledge you, Councilwoman Sunayoshi. I've always admired your passion and pride, and it just showed up here this morning in representing your community and in this significant achievement. And as you just heard, it's pretty comprehensive. So this wouldn't be a press conference unless we had Council Chair Tommy Waters come up here, because I think he deserves to say a few words as well.
Hello, everyone. Now, I just wanted to echo the sentiments of the mayor, DPP, and Council Member Tsuniyoshi. This really was her fortitude, her willingness to fight hard for her community and not give up, because at some points it was touch and go. Like DPP said, this was 10 years in the making, but for her hard work and like I said, just fortitude to get this thing passed, and all the credit to you and DPP, and you, Mayor, by the way. This is one of three sustainability plans that we hope to give you, and the importance of these things, right? It guides development, it guides our growth, and it guides DPP, and it really came from the community. You know, we had numerous people testifying from Ko'olaloa who came out and expressed themselves, and it was really a product of us listening to them. It really was. And your efforts, again, I can't say enough about how hard Councilmember Tsuniyoshi and how hard DPP worked on this. And really want to thank you also, Mayor, because this is so important. It really does guide our future. This is going to be here for 10 years. We hope to put on your desk soon, Mayor, the East Honolulu Sustainability Plan, which is my district, as well as the Central Oahu Sustainability Plan, which is equally important to each of us on the council. And this again was a good example of the council working with you, Mayor, and DPP to get this done. So thank you again, Mr. Mayor. Appreciate all your aloha, and thank you, DPP, and thank you again, Councilmember Tsuniyoshi, and congratulations. Aloha.
So once again, as I started out, this is just a great moment. It's momentous. I'm very proud and privileged to be part of this now, but I really want to thank you, all of you again. Eugene, for the incredible hard work at DPP in making this happen. To Heidi Sunayoshi, who again, as Council Chair Waters just mentioned, I understand your drive, and it's always about that, and that makes a big difference. So congratulations to you as well, and certainly to the residents and to Chair Waters. Thank you for your kind words. So 10 years in the making, we've done it. I look forward to making things happen. I look forward to those plans coming across our desk and serving the people of this island in ways that they deserve to be served. This is a great moment in time. Thank you all. Aloha.
hold it up for the, yeah, I had the other powder in front of me, whether that went clear. Okay? Keep looking. Keep looking. Keep smiling. Keep looking. Keep looking. All right, thank you guys.
Oh, thank you, Greg.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations again.
Thank you. Congratulations again.
We can. You want to come up there?
Yeah. Okay.
No, I want to show you something. Are you getting your camera? Oh, you hooked up? I'll show you before you. I want to show you something.
You good? Okay.
Can I take my mask off or on?
You can take it off.
Hello.
Hello, Megan.
Mayor, this first one's from KHON2, from Jen Boniza. You mentioned you wanted to wait for the incubation period for Super Bowl spreaders, Valentine's Day, things like that to pass. Why not end the extension on March 1 rather than March 15?
Well, because we want to be realistic about timetables here, and I don't want to create something that we might not be able to deliver. Our plan right now would be the week after this coming week to talk with the governor. Now, I'm very encouraged that 5 days into it, 5 days in a row right now, we're averaging less than 50 cases per day on Oahu, and a positivity rate well below 2.5. So something could even happen prior. But out of a courtesy to the governor, and an understanding of the concerns over the Super Bowl surge, and quite honestly, even this coming weekend with Valentine's Day, we wanted to give it some time. So if our anticipation is to meet within the last couple of days of this month, asking for some relaxations, realistically, we think the 30-day time period is probably what's going to work. And you know, so much of what we're doing right now is about managing expectations, and I don't want to mislead the public in any way, shape, or form.
And you have the power to change up the tier system however way you like. Do you think it's an effective system you'd like to keep?
I don't have complete power to do that. It needs the governor's approval and Dr. Cho's. So that was one of the things that I learned early on. And so I chose, and I've chosen, to actually defer to them from the standpoint of the governing body and not confuse anybody about, you know, what we would like to see happen versus what might really happen. And I think that that could be really a disservice to the public.
What?
So,
sorry. Go ahead. What would you like to see happen?
Well, I would really like to see us move to Tier 3 if we're fortunate enough that this current trend right now actually holds up. That would be good. But, you know, at the end of the day, I've got some provisions that I'd like to present to the governor, and we'll just see where we are at that point in time.
team sports and bars, any progress on that? Is that really all part of Tier 3 development?
I think it's part of the proposal we want to make. We've been in constant conversations with bars, the Restaurant Association, groups interested in sports. We've taken in all of that, and we want to be reasonable. And again, this is always about public safety, but we think we've come to a point in time now where we could, if we can't get to Tier 3 in this current spread, where we could absolutely relax some of the conditions that were imposed during Tier 2, because we feel really good, keeping in mind that we now have the benefit of the vaccinations and what that's bringing about it. And what's really bringing about is the fact that we are protecting our most vulnerable. So in the spirit of everything good for public health, protecting our most vulnerable, not only our kapuna, but our frontline people who are out there in contact, has been priority one. And I feel really good about the progress we're making there.
You mentioned having conversations with sports teams and bar owners and restaurant owners. For people who are still upset they're not included in this revision so far, what is your message to them?
Just to hang in there. We've gone through this, it's almost a year. We are really close. We're very aware of the hardship that's been imposed. We're very aware of even all the benefits it would be to get our kids out there playing again in practice fields and being able to be the people that they are, our young people who really need this physically and psychologically in every other way. So just hang in there. We're close. Need a little bit more patience.
And if, I don't know if it's too early to ask this, but where is that balance between the health and safety and, of course, keeping the economy alive? When is those mitigation efforts, perhaps, if those cases spike again because of these reopenings in the future?
I think all along it has been a fine line to walk, if you will, on public health and trying to create a stable economy. And so at this point here, I think we've made big strides in the public health. That's what we've been really focused on all these months. I think it's about time now we can start moving up into a place where we are paying attention to our economy as well.
Mm-hmm. And finally, just to clarify, I know you don't have like total power because it requires the governor and Dr. Char's input on the tier system, but in a perfect world, what would your system look like? Is it still gonna be a tier system?
I think the tier system has been probably the best way to create behavior modification, if you will, to encourage people. And I've been really encouraged. We noticed it yesterday in Waikiki about the amount of people walking down sidewalks, wearing masks, socially distancing. I think all of us are much more aware today of where we were. And not only that, the businesses that are open, their practices and what they're doing. And I think that's part of the reason why for five straight days, today, in fact, we only had 33 cases and a 1.4 positivity rate. We're seeing really low numbers. That's a result of what everybody is doing. I think it's too early, from what the medical experts say, to say that the vaccine is already paying off. That's not the case. I think what we're seeing is the diligence of people who really care, who've grown weary, who've grown tired, if not exhausted, from the restraints of this epidemic. But people now today, in good conscience, are responding in ways that we should. It is our kuleana. And in that regard, people are responding accordingly.
Are the numbers in the current tier system too conservative, like 10 cases per day to move?
You know what, that would be me going back and second guessing it, okay? You know, they structured the tier system. I've accepted it to be what it is. I said early on we'd stay with the tier system, but that doesn't mean we can't relax tier two if we have to do it, if in fact we don't actually get to move to tier three.
Thank you.
Okay.
Mayor Sammy at Hawaii News Now wants to know if that March 15th date was your idea or the Gov.
No, that was my idea. Again, I want to say it, reasonable timetable. If we're having a conversation in the governor's office the last couple of days of February, we have yet to set that appointment. But if we're having that conversation, I just wanted to be realistic.
And we know it could have been longer, we know it could have been shorter, but what kind of consideration, you mentioned you spoke to the businesses, what kind of consideration was put in regarding the decision for businesses who are barely holding on as it is?
Well, I think the consideration right now, first and foremost, for those businesses holding on, is hopefully we get some federal monies that we can disperse to the most needy. And that's a big important one because we now have word from Washington that those monies will be coming. I don't have the timetable, but the clock is ticking. It's ticking fast. We understand the urgency of this and we want to do everything possible. But I also want to say it again. I want to be realistic about things that we say and what we can do for the public and be sure we can deliver on what we say that they can reasonably expect.
And Casey Harlow at Hawaii Public Radio wants to know your concerns going forward. You mentioned the Super Bowl coming up. We have a 3-day weekend. Your concerns about gatherings and these kinds of events?
Well, you know, we are concerned about that. I mean, we mentioned Valentine's Day, but again, I don't know what people did on Super Bowl Sunday. I watched the game with my son and my wife. There were three of us. I don't know what other people did. We're just hoping that, you know, we try to put out as many warnings as we could, and people were aware of it, that we didn't have the large gatherings. I'm sure there were some. I'm sure there were. But at the end of the day, we'll see what happens now in the aftermath and whether or not we actually experience a surge.
You mentioned the federal dollars earlier for the most needy. What are some of those categories that fall under most needy?
Well, I think, you know, we've got a lot of business owners right now that just have had, you know, been granting forbearance, haven't collected rents, haven't had revenues coming in to run those businesses. It's been strictly an outflow. So we're really sensitive to that because business owners also employ people. And if, in fact, they have to close their doors, people will be out of work. That's clearly one. And then we'll take a look at it as we begin to prioritize once we see what conditions are going to be imposed on us, if you will, on distribution of funds. But we clearly, I can tell you from our office standpoint, and I've not been through this before, this will be first time around for us because we didn't administer the last dollars. We'll make every effort to use monies where we feel like the greatest pain and suffering is taking place.
Okay. That's it, Mayor.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.